Hey, just want to end, say hi and welcome everybody to what we're doing is a racism, a conversation for change. And so the whole point of this is we're just sitting down, we're having a chat with some people and different people, different contexts, and really just getting on the journey of understanding and understanding what it actually is like to live your life and see your life play out in a world which is not weighted your way. And we all know the conversation about when it regard to racism and Black Lives Matter and all of that. And I just think it's a really important thing that we get on this journey of understanding, because when we understand, it's amazing once you start hearing people's story. And the most common thing that I think I hear people say is, I had no idea, I did not know, I did not understand. And it's amazing once you, like everything, once you start to understand something, and especially from the human point of view, in other words, their experience, then change. Change is, I believe, the thing that flows from that. And so that's what this is all about. It's just about conversation, it's about understanding, and it's about learning. And so tonight we've got a couple of friends, and we've got Michael Brown. Michael Brown, who for a lot of people in the life of our church know you. I'm not sure they really know you, but they know you, and we'll get to in a moment what really know you means. And we've got Sinitta, and so for a lot of people know who Sinitta is, but then maybe there's a whole nother lot of people who don't really know the Sinitta.
Yeah.
So Dan.
Yeah, it's so good to have you both here. Thanks for taking the time out to be with us. And like Gary said, you know, there's people that may know you, may have seen you, and Sinitta, people may have seen you with Simon Cowell on the X Factor at the judges' houses.
Yeah.
Why don't we take a look?
Good for you.
That was really good.
She's missing that star belief.
So Tracy's hoping that her last performance will be enough to get her one step closer to her dream.
So that's interesting. That's real interesting seeing that. And people would have seen you in the judges' houses with Simon in more recent years, but not knowing maybe what a huge pop star you were in the 80s.
Hey, yeah.
Let's take a look at that.
So this is...
Oh my gosh. At least it's on the Well, that's where all the budget went on this video, this actor.
This was a 300-pound music video.
Yeah. And he got all the money and the taxi driver.
Amazing. That's pretty cool. You said that was £300 to make that video.
That video, Simon Cowell, who, because I was his first pop artist, called me and said, we're in the charts, we need to make a video. I've got £300. Grab something to wear and meet me at so-and-so's flat. And I kind of took what I owned, like my three outfits, and there it is.
No way. That's so cool. And then we got Michael Brown. And everyone in the life of church, both of you have been in the life of church for 20 years, but everyone know you, Michael, as Mama Brown.
Yeah.
And you're just a mum to everyone and to all. But they wouldn't know, maybe they wouldn't know, that you're a huge pop star as well in the 80s and years before.
Yeah.
Let's take a look. So was that music video your idea?
No, it was Tom Hayden, the
head of the record company in Los Angeles. It's his idea. And we paid all of the guys in the gym $1 because they all wanted to be in a Michael Brown video. So it's like...
Wow. Expensive. A lot of expense spent on the...
On the video.
Way back then. But also, I think... So your first song, mm-hmm. was...
So Macho.
Yep, that was the biggest selling song of the year.
Yep.
Wow. Yep.
And then following on, so through the rest of your pop career, mm-hmm. there was 14 top 10, is it 14?
Yeah, 14 more, because after that song, I then joined Stock Aitken Waterman, who did all Kylie stuff as well. And so they would write the songs, oh, Bye Bye Scarlet. And yeah, so it was like whole of the 80s and then the rest, early part of the 90s.
Okay, yeah. All right. So Michael, so your song.
Yeah.
No, there was other songs as well. But you gave me a brag on it one day. I just thought this is a good brag for anybody that mm-hmm. understands music and all that sort of stuff. So that song was number one all around the world.
Yeah.
For I'm not sure how many weeks.
I'm not sure for how many weeks either, but I was voted the... fifth top female vocalist in the world with Tina Turner and Madonna and people under me.
Okay.
In Billboard.
In that period of time.
Yeah.
And so, but there was one particular music artist that had a string of number one hits that didn't get number one because of you were number one. That was your brag.
That was my brag.
Come on, give me the brag.
It was the same year that Michael had Billie Jean out.
Michael who?
Michael Jackson.
Michael Jackson.
Yeah. And it's like...
So,
name drop.
So that's a name. So Billie Jean didn't go number one because Michael Brown's song was number one.
So many men kept it out of the charts for like 2 weeks, I think. So.
That's amazing. A $20 video.
All right, okay. All right, so let's get into this, and so just a little bit of context on why we're showing the videos as well. So you're Motown?
Yes, I was born in Motown.
And so if you wanted to put a music, I don't know if all the correct terminologies, but a collection of music style, perhaps, and artists. Mm-hmm. You would have been considered as part of the Motown crew in that era.
Yes.
Yeah. Of which, now, because we're talking about race and we're talking about everything that comes with the whole, everything from exploitation to oppression and suppression and all of those sorts of things, right? Mm-hmm. So Motown was a little bit like, if I remember Motown, which I'm sort of, was a little bit like that's black people's music that white people decided they liked. Would that be fair enough?
Yes.
Overgeneralization or?
It's kind of right in that what Berry did is like he softened the Supremes to get it over because...
What do you mean, get it over?
To get it over into the white charts.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Because the lead singer of the Supremes was a girl called Florence Ballard.
Oh, I thought it was Diana Ross.
No, the lead singer was Florence Ballard, and mm-hmm. Florence had more of a Aretha Franklin type of voice. Oh, yeah. And she sang, and it was the wrong image. It was just another black group, you know? It kind of like Gladys Knight and the Pips. Gladys had a strong black voice. Diana sounded white.
Okay.
So Diana started dating the head of the company.
So pressure then, all right? So sorry to cut you off.
Okay.
So how much pressure then for you, right? So because I've known you a long time and I've listened to you, sing, right? I've listened to you sing. I'm Michael Brown singing, right? And I've watched it, you know, if I use the term, bring the house down, right? Like, as in people just, wow. Which doesn't sound like Michael Brown, so many men, so little time.
No.
So has there been this pressure on you to...
You want it to sound white. because otherwise you don't get out there. So it's like, to this day, I think I can't sing really hardcore gospel like Aretha Franklin. Yet Aretha Franklin lived like maybe as far as we are now from the train station, from where I lived. But I want it to sound like Nancy Wilson or...
So why?
Because if I sounded like that, then people wouldn't know. It's like even when So Many Men was released in America, they didn't put my picture on the cover of the album, of the record, because it sounded like a white voice. And so therefore, even singing So Many Men, So Little Town, and so they just had Little Men. The cover was just Little Men, like you see on a toilet, you know, those little men. All across the sleeve.
So how does that make you feel, knowing that you've got to conform? So you know, you said they softened the Supremes.
Well,
they conformed them. But how does that make you feel?
At the time, because I just wanted to get out there, I just wanted to be heard, it's like I thought, oh, well, that's okay then. It's okay, because just to get the first record out there, it's okay. And then the next one, they'll put me on the sleeve. And then people will realize that this is what I look like. So the next album, of course, had a big, giant picture of me. But you just accepted it because it's like, I mean, I did a TV show here called with Bruce Forsyth. Bruce Forsyth's Bring on the Girls. And every black female artist in this country that was somebody at the time, i.e. Patti Boulé, Grace Kennedy, Madeline Bell, Pearly Gates.
Sheila Fuggit.
No, not Sheila, Holly Allen Smith and myself. We were all asked to do the show and all told that we were going to get to sing whatever our latest record was or whatever. When we got there, they put us all in dresses alike, stood us on each side of a staircase, and had Bruce Forsyth walking down the middle of the staircase singing, pack up all my cares and go, here I go, high and low, bye, bye, blackbirds. And I, in rehearsal, said, I'm not doing this. I was hired to sing, and at that time I had a track out called Close to Perfection. I was hired to sing this song, and I'm not going to be up there letting this man sing Bye Bye Blackbird with me dressed like all the other girls. So I balked, and David, the producer, said, if I didn't do it, I would never work on television again. And I said, well, if this is all television has to offer, I don't want to work on television again. And so my manager, my agent and manager at the time said, you have to do the show, because if you don't, they will sue me because I signed the contract on your behalf and I committed to doing it. So I did it. And I told the guy, I said, I don't want to work for you ever again. So don't ever hire me again. That was it.
Oh, well. So, Sinitta, so...
it's crazy that you
think... dog's back.
Like, that just couldn't even happen today. I'm not saying today's perfect, but it's more outrageous hearing about it now, because that was the norm then. And Bruce Forsyth was such a huge star. He was the face of Saturday night family entertainment. And that was the gag.
What year was this?
This was...
84, something like that?
Somewhere around in there. Yeah. It's like, yeah. It's like... we're talking about the 80s.
Yeah. And he's married. He was actually married to a black woman.
Yeah, yeah.
So he's not a racist, but the writers of the show thought that was a great gag.
Yeah.
Oh. Wow. So, Sinitta, I assumed that I left the obvious out. Sinitta happens to be the daughter of Michael.
Yeah, we didn't say that.
That's right.
If you couldn't tell.
I was just thinking, we forgot to give the connection of why Michael and Sinitta, right? Yeah. So, Sinitta, you... Okay, so we've got... So, in the 80s, I guess there's... so many of the songs and and all of that. But so you're a daughter of Motown, mm-hmm. if I put it like that.
Yeah.
And so you grew up in the music and all of the complexities that brings, and I guess was probably even more complex back then than it is now. But so would I be fair enough in saying if you weren't the first, you were one of the first, if I use the term black girls mm-hmm. singing white people's pop music?
Is that a... Yeah, definitely fair to say that, yeah.
Did you feel like that was the pitch, or did you feel... How did that play out?
I mean, the thing is that's what I wanted to do because I'd sort of grown up obviously hearing and understanding the struggles. And also, I think I sort of associating black music and the black struggle with pain and rejection. And I wanted to be included, you know, I want to be included in the fun part because I grew up backstage seeing all the good sides, but also witnessing the struggles to get there. And so I was thinking, I wish we could kind of show people that black people are actually fun and nice and that we're not scary and that we're okay. And so I was like, I don't want to sing gospel. I didn't want to sing songs associated with pain and struggle and suffering because I was like, you know, what if we could change all that? And naively you think, well, if I don't sing that kind of music, people won't associate me with that. And then they'll see, look, black people can be funny and fun and enjoyable and positive, and I just wanted to radiate all those things. So lots of record companies were interested in signing me at the time. I had quite a good image, you know, I had the Michael Jackson curly perm hair and I could dance. And but everyone wanted me to sing gospel or soul or jazz or something. And I was like, I want to sing pop, you know, like Madonna, I want to sing. And everyone was like, yeah, well, you know, that's not going to happen, but you're really good, we really want to work with you, but, you know, you've got to sing. And I was like, no, I want to sing pop music like Madonna.
Like?
Madonna, because she was, like, the most popular singer at the time, and
They were convincing you to go the other route.
Yeah, everybody was like, we'll give you a deal, but you need to sing gospel or soul or jazz or... you know, anything that was black music.
Is that because you're black and this is where black belongs?
Yeah.
And you don't...
Because you're a black girl and you're commercial, but you're going to sing black music, and that's the USP, is you're going to be a black girl who looks commercial but who sings black music. And I was like, but I want to sing music like Madonna. I want to sing pop, you know, Holidays, happy stuff. So then I met the very young Simon Cowell at the time, and he was like, you know, I'll sign you. He had his record company above where my agency was. And he said, I'll sign you. And I was like, well, I'll sign to you if I can sing pop. You know, but who else do you have on your label? And he had no one. They were a startup. They just moved in. They had no artists, no hits, no experience. But he was like, I get it. There's nobody like you. Let's do it. So we made So Matcha. We started promoting the record around the place. It was doing amazingly in all the clubs. Went to take it to radio, and the radio stations were still segregated in 1986, believe it or not.
Segregated
in the United States.
Segregated, explain.
In that there was black music or soul music, country music, classical music, pop music, and it sort of went like this. So so there was radio shows for specific genres of music, and black people sang soul, jazz, or gospel. So when my records were being received to the DJs, obviously we were sending it to pop because it was a pure pop record, and they'd put it on and sort of go, oh yeah, that sounds great. You know, who is this? Oh, it's a black girl. Okay, yeah, no, I won't play this. I'll send this to the soul division, who'd go, oh, soul thing. Oh, this is pop, let's send it to... And my record sort of did this for about 2 years because nobody knew what to do with it because I sounded like this but looked like that. So same thing happened. Simon went, the only way we're going to break this record is to take your picture off of the cover. Takes my picture off the cover, puts a cartoon medallion man on the cover. It blows up. So the record sells so quickly, they can't keep up with the printing. It's like... smashes, like we said, Guinness Book of Records.
That's without, because your face
because
wasn't on it.
Because my face is now gone from the cover of the
Guinness Book of Records.
Yeah.
Wow.
And, I mean, so it's bittersweet. It's great because you're having this massive hit record, but at the same time, you're kind of going, wow, am I that ugly? am I this? Because when you're young, you don't think of racism. You don't think of the politics behind racism. You just think it's a I like or dislike black people. So for me, where I thought, well, I'm very friendly and, you know, well-educated, well-brought-up, I'm a nice girl. If you don't want to buy my record with the picture on the cover, it means you don't like me and you think I'm ugly. So self-esteem, boom, but career flying.
Wow.
Yeah.
So, you know, I remember I was talking to you, just one last question and then I'll go. Mm-hmm. So, and you were, so at the same time, mm-hmm. there was Sinitta, mm-hmm. and there was a girl called Kylie Minogue.
Yeah.
And you and her were, you knew each other, you're friendly, you're friends, all of that.
Yeah.
But then it was very much, there was Sinitta and there's Kylie Minogue. And you said something to me.
Do you know, it's the biggest, one of the saddest things. And obviously, you know, as a black person, there's racism everywhere in its different forms. But the saddest thing about this is I got to join the Hit Factory, which was Stock Aitken Waterman, who were kind of the Motown of the 80s. And Kylie was with their big signing from Australia that was on the thing. We were the same age, we were friends, we liked each other, we all toured together. And I went to do a Saturday morning TV show because that was how you promoted the records in those days. And it was a black gay presenter hosting the show. And I was on promoting my latest single, very excited. And he said, oh yes, okay, before we sign off, we'd done the interview, it'd gone really well. I just got one question to ask you. And I said, what's that? And he said, are you Team Sinitta or Team Kylie? And I sort of went, oh, well, obviously I love Kylie, but I have to say I'm Team Sinitta because I'm Sinitta, right? And he went, okay, fair enough, but I've got to let you know I'm Team Kylie. And it was like, kind of, why would you bring that up then? Because they pitted us against each other as a marketing ploy. Because I was popular and Kylie was popular, the media decided that kids had to decide whether they liked me or Kylie. So you couldn't have us both.
Wow.
And Kylie and I used to not be able to be publicly friends because we were supposed to be part of this adversary thing. Meanwhile, we'd sneak out and go to clubs dancing together and all this sort of stuff. And we'd tour together out of the country in Japan and things, actually share the bill. But, you know, there was just always this you're either in or you're out, or you can have her or you can have me. And we're still like fighting that today. People will go, oh, so you and Kylie are actually friends. It's like, yeah, we were great friends.
Wow.
So I don't know if you've got, because I was going to ask Michael. So having your, because we'll get into your experience in a moment, right?
Yeah.
So now you're her mum.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Watching her navigate this from your own, just through your own, how did that feel? What was?
Well, the thing is, it's like she was navigating that at the same time I was doing something, because we were, the first time in the Guinness Book of Records that a mother and daughter are in the charts at the same time. So I was going in this direction, she was going that direction, and I didn't know about all of the, that they had pitted them against each other. And until after it had all happened, you know. Yeah.
But even just her, not the pitting, but mm-hmm. you're navigating this yourself.
Yeah.
As a mum and as an artist, and you're watching your daughter navigate it as well.
Sorry to interrupt, but this is another thing. So Whitney Houston and Sissy Houston were American mother and daughter who were in the charts at the same time in America. The other thing that the labels, record labels did to us at the time, I mean, we're friends with these people, but the way that things were in those days, we also weren't allowed to admit that we were mother and daughter. Oh, because it was also an ageist thing as well.
Yeah. And it's like, and I had Madonna as a support act to me, and I was helping her. I was actually helping her get herself out there.
Well, you did a good job.
Yeah, I did. I did. I really did. Helping her get her foot in the door. It's like calling people and saying, hire this girl because she's really good. She's my support act here in New York, and I'm sure the guys will like her because we had huge gay followers. And I was getting people to hire her, and she was saying, oh, thank you so much. It's like, if I could just ever be half as good as you. It's a lot of mess, but anyway.
But anyway, so, all right, I just think, just because I was going to ask a question, unless you got something, I just think it's important, because you mentioned Simon, mm-hmm. right? You're working with him on X Factor,
yeah.
and you're talking to him. He was your producer.
Yeah, was first, producer, he was the manager, record company, so he's
record company.
The A&R man who signed me and all of that.
First song, all of that. Mm-hmm. You and him have been friends ever since, mm-hmm. And you know, from, you know, what if I was going to say that? And he's always been cheer squad for Sinitta. Mm-hmm. Is that fair enough?
Yeah,
100%. Because I think what's important is that be careful that the association that you're a product of.
Yeah. That. Oh, gosh, I tell
you
what.
That's what I'm trying to say.
Those days, you know, what Simon had to go through, he learned as a young, successful white man what it was like to be a black girl in the music industry, because he used to have to take me everywhere. You know, I was a minor, so he'd be driving me to gigs and events and this whole thing, and seeing how I was treated. You know, he was like my little bodyguard in a lot of ways, because I'd be performing and people wouldn't want to let me in, and he'd be sort of having to have confrontations with people. Sometimes customs would let guys go through reeking of marijuana, you know, and looking a complete state, and I'd look really presentable but get pulled over, and he'd be sort of saying, why have you pulled her over? It's because she's black, isn't she? And he had to go through all this stuff with me. So, you know, he kind of got a different kind of education, which I think has given him a lot of empathy,
yeah.
you know, for years, to realize, wow, it is really different. And we didn't consider that we were having the hardest time compared to a lot of people. And people will sort of say, oh, well, you didn't really experience racism because you were allowed in, you were invited to the party, as they say. But in a way, it's great to be invited to the party, but it's difficult when you're invited to the party and you're the only one, because somebody's got to sit next to you at the table, and some people consider sitting next to you as having the bad seat and things like that. Or, you know, you're trying to swallow a meal and you can tell that certain people resent you being there, and you're having to still smile and be brave through all those things. Mm. You know, and he'd be by my side sort of going, you know, don't worry, you deserve to be here. You know what I mean? They've asked you to perform after this dinner, so you deserve to sit here and eat the dinner. And, you know, he'd have to sort of almost be my backbone through these things, because it was terrifying. And so it would be quite funny, because, not funny, but nowadays when people talk about different things and they sort of think, what do you know? Because I'm seen as being the girl who was always allowed everywhere. And I was still fighting in a way.
Yeah.
And because people were having to learn through me, you know, some people, I was the only black person they knew. So compliments from people were, oh, but you're not like a proper black person, are you? No, really? You know, but they meant it kindly.
Yeah.
Things like that. So.
So how does that make you feel walking into those spaces, walking into those rooms, knowing that you're invited to the party, but if we put it this way, no one's going to ask you to dance? Like, there's no inclusion. You're just at the party and you've got to really prove yourself.
It's a horrible feeling, but you get so used to it. But the funny thing is I think as humans, before church, I think as a natural human, it doesn't matter if 99 people are welcoming. The one you feel the most is the one that resents you being there. And so you're always aware of where that person is. You can feel their daggers across the room, and it's a real thing. It's not just paranoia. But you also don't want to affect other people by bringing the racist thing into the crowd, into the mood. So you learn to just absorb it and deal with it yourself. And so you do build a lot of inner strength and feel responsible. It's like it's your fault. Like, if I wasn't here, this would be happening, kind of thing.
Yeah, yeah. I love that you said inner strength, because often you could feel weak, but it actually makes you stronger.
Because you've got to be there. You've got to stand up, and you've got to smile and turn it on. Yeah.
So, yeah, all right.
I was going to say, but you learn to fight it on even the smallest level. Because you don't want anyone, because you get such a a hard shell on your back, that the least little thing, you attack it before it grows any larger. I mean, like, I've attacked people for buying an ice cream cone. Going to buy an ice cream cone in this country, and I say, like, I want 3 scoops. They've got these cones that have 2 scoops, and I want 1 vanilla, 1 chocolate, 1 strawberry. And they're going like, you have to pick one of the two because we only sell 2. I said, well, I'm willing to pay whatever it costs. No, we can only sell 2. I said, okay, well, give me a cone with 1 scoop of chocolate and 1 scoop of vanilla. Then give me a single cone with 1 scoop of strawberry. Then I take it, turn it on top and say, throw this away for me and let me pay you. And they just look at me like I'm crazy. And it's simply because I figure, well, you think because I'm black, I don't know what I want. And you think that my money is not as good as the next person's. Mm. Why can't you just sell me what I want? And so maybe they're just doing their job. They're just being normal. But because of having had to fight so many other things, a simple thing like that
becomes a fight.
Yeah, becomes a fight because it's like, at least I know I can do this and show them that they can sell somebody what they want if they've got the money to pay for it.
Yeah. And do you think, like, within the time that we're in now, within society, right, do you think one of the biggest reasons why this is the conversation can't stop, won't stop, and there's such a uproar within people is because, like you've been saying, we've learned to just deal with it, suppress it, go about it, and now it's just, I don't know, enough is enough, or...
I kind of feel like it's your fault. I mean, because I didn't want to upset people, and because you kind of realise that some people are racist because that's their normal, so it's sort of not their fault because that's the way you've been raised, so you don't want to sort of cause a problem, but then you realize by not speaking up or by accepting things that maybe you're helping to enable it to go on longer. Yeah. So I think today is a good day because people are talking and because we can gently express what's not okay without it seeming confrontational, you know, and to be able to say, you know what, black people don't hate white people, we just hate being hated. it's like that.
Yeah.
And that's what I'm relieved for, and I think that's what I was waiting for. So people could sort of think, oh, well, you're a sellout because, you know, you date white men and you sing white music. And because I was raised not to be colorblind, but to, you know, if you have a litter of puppies, it's like, you know, I'm the black one. You know, I didn't expect to be hated for being the black one. I thought the black one was special, to be honest. So when you understand how deep it all is, you realize it is important to speak. But it's not for black people to speak, it's for us to all speak together like this, because we're all part of that change, and that's what's amazing.
Yeah.
There's so many white and other sort of races coming together to kind of, actually, we're fighting for humanity.
Yeah.
You know, not just for black life. And that's why it feels safe as well to get it into the conversation without people thinking that you are full of hatred.
So Miquel, right? Mm-hmm. So the civil rights. Let's go way back to, yeah. Way back to civil rights.
Civil rights, yes.
Right. So, you know, in the 60s, you got, you know, probably the most famous civil rights leader, Martin Luther King Jr.
Yeah.
Right? And everything that was in that era. So you've got memories of being a little kid in that era.
Yeah.
And the experiences. And so just go back to what it was, because we got people talking about living with it now and all of that. And I think it's just good to hear from people that you know, because most people's experience, I would think, with civil rights and what they were standing up against is through video footage,
yeah.
et cetera, et cetera. And I just thought, and you know, there's lots of people still alive who are part of it, I realize that, but just give just first-hand experience of being a young person back then, experiences with your grandfather and your grandmother and your son. Your mum passed away when you were...
No, I was born.
When you were born?
Yeah.
So you were raised by your grandparents?
Yeah.
So just let's just pick up Michael Brown before she was Michael Brown singing So Many Men, So Little Time.
Well, my earliest memories are... My grandfather was an architect and a property developer and had his own building firm and everything. And so they were kind of, I guess you'd say, an affluent family, you know. So my grandmother always traveled first class on the trains. And my earliest memory is of her trying to get on a train to go to Indianapolis with me to visit some relatives. And meanwhile, like, my grandmother was white and my grandfather is black, black American. And she got on the train and the conductor said, I'm sorry, ma'am, but that child can't ride in here. And this is for whites only. And she said, oh, don't be ridiculous. This is just a baby. She can't ride on the train on her own. He said, well, no, ma'am, but she can't ride in this section because it's for whites only. And she said, so what am I supposed to do? And he said, well, you can ride in the colored section if you want to, but she can't ride in here. Now, the white train had beautiful velvet, this color, kind of burgundy velvet seats that were like... just beautiful, like someone's sofa. And she's just got off the train and got into the so-called colored section. And they were like hard wooden benches like you'd see in pews in a church. No kind of covering or anything on them. And that's where we had to sit. And so she had a bottle and she asked Tim if he could warm this, take the chill off, because it was a bottle of milk for me. And he said, and where am I supposed to do that, ma'am? And she says, well, I'm sure there's some place you can warm it. She said, yeah. He said, yeah, in the white section, but there's no place like that in here, in this section. He says, you have to just, she'll have to drink it as it is. And there was a lady, a heavyset lady, sitting opposite on the next bench, and she was quite fat. And she said, ma'am, just give it to me. So my grandmother gave it to her, and the lady put it under her arm and kept it for some time and then gave it back. And she said, I'm sure that will have taken the chill off a bit.
Bless her.
And, and when my grandmother gave it to me to drink. That's the first thing that I can remember if I'm thinking back. And another instance, like my grandfather, like I said, was this property developer, and he built a subdivision in Franklin, Tennessee, called Rucker Subdivision. There's a street there now called Rucker Avenue and another street called Valina Drive, which is my mother's first name, and a park called Rucker Memorial Park, named after my grandfather. But he built this community of all these beautiful houses and would only sell to black people who could afford to buy them. And whatever they wanted to pay for him, he would build a house to what they could afford. And he collected from them each month so they didn't have to get mortgages from the bank. They bought the houses as if they were renting the properties. And the only thing they had to do is sign a contract saying that they would not sell those houses to a white person until 50 years after his death. And the houses are just being, some of the people are selling the houses now in that area. When I went there in 2018 and some of the houses were being sold now.
Wow.
So he was one of the first civil rights activists, in spite of the fact that he was married to a white woman. He was like, no, because during that period of time, black people weren't allowed to go to the parks, the public parks. Mm. So my grandfather built this community and had a big park at the end of the community
with swings and slides and a baseball diamond so that black people could go to a park because it was against the law for us to go to parks.
So what if, I had a convo once, and then I guess then there's loads of questions on how that makes you feel. But I just wonder when you're in the car.
Yeah. Tell that story.
It's like we were on our way to a place called Murfreesboro, and I was just looking out the car window, and my grandfather was driving, and my grandmother was sitting in the back, and I was in the back with her, and I was looking out the window, and I said, Papa, look, there's some Halloween ghost over there. I said, is it Halloween? And he was saying, no, it's not Halloween. He said, Florence, put the baby on the floor. And so my grandmother made me get down on the floor in the car, in the back, underneath her knees, and she had a blanket over her knees. And he said, we're gonna play a game. You're gonna hide and you're gonna be real quiet. You're not gonna say anything until I speak. And I said, okay, Papa. And so I hid under her knees, and this man, one of the Ku Klux Klan, stopped the car and said, where are you going there, boy? And my grandfather said, oh, I just going wherever she tell me to go, boss, you know, wherever she tell me to go. And I was listening to Papa because Papa, this man was an architect, you know, with his own team of people. He was usually not quite the orator as Obama, but he spoke correctly and always was always correcting me. You know, where I'd ask where is something at, and he said behind the preposition, and I was going like, okay, so this is my grandfather sounding like I don't know what, and he said, knocked on the window and said, where are you going, ma'am? And she said, I'm going to Murfreesboro to visit some relatives. And he said, and this boy driving here, how long's he been driving for you? And she said, oh, he's been driving ever since he's been, a teenager. It's like his parents worked for us and, he's been in the family for years.
So she had to play the game.
Yep.
Your grandfather had to play the game.
Yeah. And
What's going through your head? How old were you then?
I had to be about 5, 6 years old.
So 5, 6 years old, there must be something going through your head. But then there must have been a time later on where it clocked exactly what was taking place.
When I was 7, it's like it really clocked because a thing called a Dairy Queen, which is like an ice cream parlor, opened, and it had a sign on the thing saying no coloreds, but you could get service at the window outside, but no coloreds were allowed inside. And my grandfather by this time had cataracts growing over his eyes, and I was kind of like his lead dog because you have to wait until they really get ripe before they can operate and take them off. So I said, Papa, I want an ice cream. He said, there's no place around here to get ice cream. I said, yes, it is, Papa. It's a new place that's open just up the street. And I'd already told my cousin, I said, I'm going in there, and I'm going to sit on that stool, and I'm going to order some ice cream, and I'm not going to be white. Because my cousin, Claudine, can pass for white. And so she said, yeah, and they're going to kill you, too. And I said, no, they're not. So Papa, I said, and he said, okay, well, you just go and we'll go. So we got there, went in, set up on the stools, and the lady came over, and I can see her face this day. She was like, sir, can I help you? And he said, yeah. He says, we want to get 2 ice cream cones. He says, my granddaughter here wants an ice cream cone. I guess I'll have one, too. And she said, sir, we're not allowed to serve you in here. You have to get the ice cream at the window. And he said, I'm sorry. He said, as you can see, he had a white cane at this time. He said, as you can see, I can't see. He says, I'm terribly sorry. He says, we'll go outside. And she said, well, since you're already here,
we'll just serve you. And he said, do you have a sign or anything saying such on the door? And she said, yes, sir, there's a sign on the door saying no colors allowed inside. And he said, I didn't see it. And he said, my granddaughter did, you know, she didn't see it. He said, and she can read. And the lady looked at me and I just went, like, but my grandfather had taught me to read when I was 3, so I could read. And it's like, she gave us the ice creams. And I just looked at her and licked it and said, thank you. And licked it again before we got up to leave because I was determined to sit on that stool and lick that ice cream inside that place like the white people.
Scarlett.
Even Scarlett's up on
I want to ask you a question off the back of that because I think just the other week I was sat at the kitchen table with my nan, who was brought up in South Africa during the time of apartheid, and she was telling me stories of segregation just like this, like no colours, no Indians, like whites only. And so you have an upbringing like this. How do you not have a harbouring of hatred? Or
because of God. Because of God. I tell you, if it were not for God, I would probably be dead. My grandparents were devout Christians, and it's like we were in church every Sunday, and the pastor had lunch with us every Sunday before going back to the next service. It's like, and I knew, thou shalt not kill. That was in me, and I knew that God would take care of me. The Lord was my shepherd, and I shall not want, and he would take care of me. And the 23rd Psalms and the fact that thou shalt not kill, those two things were in my head constantly all the time I was growing up. Because I had a violent temper, somebody say something the wrong way, I'd sooner punch them as to listen to them. But it's like I learned, and I learned before it was too late, before someone killed me. And I left at 15. I left my grandparents' area, but they were both dead by the time my grandfather died rather when I was 9, and my grandmother died when I was 11. And they left property and money and stuff to me that I was supposed to inherit at 21. By the time I got 21, the white lawyer and my white governess had basically stolen everything.
Oh my God.
So I didn't get my inheritance. And they've got papers. My cousin was showing me 2 years ago when I went to visit, papers that I signed when I was like 11 and 12 years old, signing papers for them to sell all the furniture, to sell everything. And it's like, I mean, what did I know about selling stuff? But it's like, there, but by God's grace, I would be dead because I would have stayed there. I went to Seattle, Washington, which is as far north and as far west as you can get, to get away from everything and to start life anew. And that's what I did. Because you don't know how to deal with it. You don't know how to deal with it. You don't understand why you have to speak slightly differently so that people think you're white when you're speaking to them on the phone. And then when you get to wherever, if you have an interview or something for university or what have you, and you get there and they see you, and you see when you first walk in, their expression change because they're expecting a white person and a black person walks in. And so you realize that you're not going to get a fair chance. So you leave. So I went to stay with my aunt in Seattle and went to the University of Washington. But if you hate the people you're hating, they don't know that you're hating them. And the hate is only eating you up. You know, you're walking around with this chip on your shoulder. And it's like, so I used to pray all the time for God to let me forgive people and to let me get over their racism and what have you, and to create in me a pure heart. And that's what he did. He just, because I didn't want to pass it on to my kids. Yeah. You know, I didn't want my child growing up as a black child. I wanted her to grow up as just a gorgeous female, period. And that's what I had to do. And I had and I wanted her to be exposed to everything, like the ballet, the opera, the, you know, everything, so that she would be well-rounded, intelligent, and I knew she was going to be gorgeous because she was my kid, you know, so.
All right. Wow. So, all right, so, I mean, there's lots. You're awesome.
Yeah.
All right, so this is the whole context, right, is conversation for change, yeah? So what does, if we had time, right, I'd be fascinated, how did you go from Seattle, Washington, mm-hmm. to I'm part of the Motown crowd, right? I mean, that mm-hmm. that would be fascinating,
yeah,
as well.
Yeah.
But just as a story, right? But the both of you, so serious question. So you're both music industry ladies, mm-hmm. and you've had to walk a journey. Both of it tough in your own shoes, right? Mm-hmm. Same, but different, right? Mm-hmm. So what does change look like? What does change feel like? Because, you know, there's so many young people who aspire to, not necessarily be you, but to do what you, mm-hmm. you've done, in the sense of, I'm just talking about chart their own course of success. Mm-hmm. In a world that is just, yeah, as we're all becoming more and more aware of, as people start talking more and more about what's got to be navigated. So what does change look like? Can you put it in words? What does change feel like? What does change look like? If you were to go, okay, things need to change. If we're talking about, just thinking mindful of, you know, young girls who are aspiring in the music industry, what does a world that has changed look like and feel like? I realize it's probably a difficult question to put into words.
For me, change looks like, it looks like Hillsong. It does. It's like, until the world has as many leaders that are black as they have that are white, as many as they have that are Chinese, or what have you, until we have that rainbow of leaders in the world, the children, you don't stand a chance. Because it's like, I've been fighting since I was 5 years old, and I'm still fighting the same fight. But if we have leaders that are black and white and Chinese and everything, the major leaders, the world can change. It's like, we've got Dan, we've got, you know, we've got the two Dans, I should say. We've got the two Dans, and it's like, for me, it's like, I don't care which one I listen to, because they're both coming out of the same book. They're both God-focused, Jesus in their heart, you know, they've got the Holy Spirit living in them, and when they speak, they're speaking from godly terms. And so I can listen to DW, or I can listen to the other Dan, yeah. And it's like, and it doesn't matter. And until I can say that about the world, like, it doesn't matter who's president, who's the head of this country, who's the head of whatever country we're looking at, until I can look at the world and see that it doesn't matter who's leading, that it's going to be fair and it's going to be just, and it's going to be, the people are going to be led through love and justice, then, you know, 100 years from today, we'll still be fighting the same battle. I mean, this is, it's boring and it's tiring to be fighting the same battle that I was fighting before my baby was even born, you know? It hurts. It's like, I loved it when Tori was about 4, I think. She must have been 4 or 5, and she couldn't find me on the stage. She came to Lincoln to see me in a play, and it was called 5 Blue-Haired Ladies Sitting on a Green Park Bench, and it was 4 white ladies and me. And Tori couldn't find me, but which one is Michael? Which one is Michael? Where's Michael?
So cute.
Did I say that?
It's like, and she loved me, and I loved her, and she couldn't find me.
Yeah.
And then he was saying, like, and he didn't want to say, oh, she's the black one, because Tori didn't, he knew that she didn't see black. So he's like, she's the third one. She's the third one from that side. Count 1, 2, and she went, oh, yeah, oh, I see Michael. And she was happy. And the thing is, Tori's still like that today. It's like, Tori sees people. And until the world can see people, it's like, yeah, okay, so your skin is brown, but you are a person, you know? It's like, the only time I need to see color is when I'm trying to differentiate, which Dan are we talking about? You know? It's like, otherwise, it's like, they're both gorgeous, they're both beautiful, they're both preaching and trying to save, you know, trying to save people. Anyway.
So think about, because, you know, you're still actively involved in the, let's call it, you know, music industry.
Yeah.
In the TV industry. So what does change?
I mean, very, very similar, actually, to what Mike Brown said. It's the leadership. There definitely needs to be more black leaders, because I think when you have leaders from different races, you do just see the people. You know, like, some people think all Chinese people look alike, or all Oriental people. And because I have friends from different parts of the Oriental communities, I can actually tell a Korean from a Japanese to a Thai to a Malaysian and all of that. And so when you actually have a connection to a group of people, I think it's easy for you to actually include them in the right ways and actually bring some heart to it.
Yeah.
And the industry's really trying hard, but it still feels like tokenism. It's a brief. It's a kind of must include a black person, someone from the LGBTQ community, and it's a bit sort of like box ticking. And that's not proper inclusivity.
Yeah, so that's always my my thing is that, you know, you can here's the policy. Mm-hmm. This is what it looks like. Here's the tick the box.
Yeah.
Versus, it's real.
Mm-hmm.
So.
And I think you get the realness by actually having diversity in the leadership, because diversity in the leadership. First of all, everyone on the leadership team is going to respect each other because you're all there for that reason. And that helps educate everyone else. Oh, this is how a Chinese person thinks. This is how a black person feels and thinks. So then when you're casting in these other realms, because otherwise what happens is, let's just use you as the example, we've got sort of white, Australian, British, Gary of a certain age casting that thing. But how do you know how a black American woman feels and all of that? So we need representation. We also need older people, which sounds weird, but because there's this whole obsession about youth. And actually, if we don't know where we come from and where the growth is and where the growth's needed, how can you change? And that's what's been so amazing about today, is because people have been able to speak and go, this has been happening since I was 5 years old.
Yeah.
Oh, the debt was only paid 5 years ago. Mm-hmm. And everyone's going, wow, what? You know, that we, you know, I think it's got to start with leadership, but there's a fear of letting black people in because they feel like, actually, because we've always had to work so much harder and be better to even get our foot in the door, that there's this fear of, if you let us in, we'll take over. But I guess what you've got to realize is that even if we did take over, we're not here to harm. We're so happy to be included, to actually have a job, to be allowed at the table. We just want to get on with it.
Yeah. All right. Now, I don't know how... I'll ask the question and we'll go from there, right? So I find myself often in a conversation. Now, often doesn't mean every week or anything like that, where it might be your name may come up. Let's call it music. I'll even go, I don't know, talent. I mean, you've got an extraordinary eye for talent and all of that. And I find myself sometimes going, no. You got to understand, she's really smart.
Yeah.
And I find myself saying it because there's almost a dismissiveness of the persona that you
created.
That's
the survival persona.
That Sinitta needs to put on this persona, if persona is the right word or what.
Yeah.
And I find myself going, no, you got no idea how switched on she is and how smart she is on these things, right? So
Thank you, do you
find yourself coming up against that?
Yeah, and even sadly in social media and things like that a lot, which is another thing, I do think the world will look a bit like social media where everyone can have a say, but in the most unsavory way where people think, oh, well, she's only sitting next to Simon because she's obviously having sex with him, or they've got some kind of sordid affair going, or she's got something on him, because how could I possibly have something to offer besides that?
Yeah.
You know, for so example.
Because how does that make... Because that's what I'm referring to.
Yeah.
And because I've known you a long time, and we talk about a lot of things, and especially when it comes to music talent, all of those sorts of things. How does that make you feel when you hear almost like you're the... I don't know, you're just the...
It's a bit of fluff.
That just sits there and just...
fluff on the side.
That's how people see it.
Yeah.
How does that make you feel?
I mean, as I've gotten older now, it's not satisfying. In a way, I think I created that persona because that thing is, again, about wanting to almost disarm people, you know, to sort of say, look, I'm okay, you know, I'm black, but don't fear me. I'm not here to do anything horrible. I'm not going to sleep with your husband. I'm not... You know, anything bad you think about a black woman, like, I'm not like that, just give me a chance. So then you sort of learn to undermine or to sort of tone down intelligence, things like that, because I think if you think that people think you're devious or that you're dangerous or something, that you're kind of always trying to, I suppose, be submissive to not seem, so that people aren't afraid of you. Mm-hmm. And unfortunately, intelligence is frightening to people who are racist.
Right, yeah.
Yeah, it's true.
And can I say something too? It's like, and what she'll hate me for this, but anyway, we're on live television.
Don't do it, Mike.
We're on live.
I'll get you.
But it's like, she didn't tell you. It's like, so macho, she got that record recorded and in the bottom of the charts by going into the office, getting them to hire her as a secretary in Simon's office with the people. They hired her as a secretary, and she was calling up people using her posh school voice and saying, oh, I have this amazing artist that you might want to have on your show. And her name is Sinitta. And it's like, and I've forgotten what name she used as a secretary, but she was calling...
Sadie LaSalle.
Who was it?
Sadie LaSalle
calling.
Come on, that's a great name.
And she would get herself placed on different shows and everything and got the record going up. So she would not tell anybody that because of her loyalty and everything. But the thing is she made herself. And once the record started moving up in the charts, then she got Simon on board, but it's like she had already recorded it, and it was...
We signed the contract after I was number two in the charts.
Yes.
Because nobody really believed until it actually happened.
Yeah.
But things like that, it's just weird. When you're a black woman, it's not a good idea to
be too smart
or...
Because that's the point of...
Too powerful.
So how much of your persona is like, I'm playing the game that everyone wants me to play because they won't accept who I actually am. And that's what I might sound being a little bit...
Yeah, it's controversial.
Only because I know you well enough to be able to say it. Like, and I say to you, no, you just don't know. I don't know how many times I've said it. You just don't know how smart this girl is.
Mm. Oh, right? Thank you.
And at the same time, it's in defense of, and I feel like going, it's just that, it's the persona. Is it the persona that you've been forced into?
Do you know what? I wasn't forced in it because, remember, initially I was the young teenager and that's all I wanted to do, bring fun and happiness. As I started to mature and grow older, I did want to change, and that's when the then label owner, not Simon, because Simon wasn't the head of the label, he was the A&R guy, but the guy who was the boss went, oh, no, you can't grow up. It was like Shirley Temple. And I was told, you are the black Shirley Temple and you can't change. When people expect Sinitta to turn, when people invite Sinitta, they want bubbly, happy, you know, Sinitta, like that's who you are. And it's like, yeah, but I'm now kind of a bit of an angsty teenager with an attitude and I've got something else to say like every other teenager. No, we don't want that. In fact, and don't even change your hair. If you change your hair, nobody will know who you are because you all look alike. I actually had it said to me. So I got kind of trapped in my own persona. And so because I kind of have this Pollyanna positive attitude that my mother taught me to be able to survive, I turned into, okay, well, I'm going to at least own this persona and I'm going to take it right over the top. So hence the leaf, just like I will be not only the black Shirley Temple, I'll be the black Goldie Hawn, I'll be the black this, I'm going to make people laugh, I'm going to have fun with this.
So how much, because we're talking about change, right?
Yeah.
So how do young girls, right, going into music, all of that, the challenge, one is for, how do people not be forced to take this persona? Mm-hmm. And how do they, just staying true to yourself.
Yeah, but 100%. Like, authenticity. I think we have kind of done the hard road and walked that path so that they don't have to. So this is one of the things I enjoyed most about working on shows like X Factor with Leono and Fleur and Alexandra Burt, because for me, my role, helping all the kids that are back there, but my main thing was like, be yourself, because I knew what it was like to be an artist that had outgrown a persona but still had to live in it. So it's like, now your intelligence is valued. You very much you have to be a business person now as well, not just an image. You've got to take care of your business. You've got to be doing something you love because it's a hard industry. Don't do it unless you would do it for free because you might not necessarily make money. And your authenticity is so important. And guess what? You're allowed to be intelligent now. You actually probably be valued more. You can be dark skin, they even have makeup that will match your skin tone. it is a better place. The struggles are still real, but it's only going to get better by you owning who you are and keeping to force the change, keeping the wheels of change in motion. Kind of don't do what I did then. I didn't know better, but don't put up with what's wrong.
And what's important is that we mm-hmm. very broad term, that we don't expect people to be not true to themselves. Yeah. That we've got a box.
Yeah, there's no such thing as a black girl. There's no such thing as you're not like a normal black girl, because there's no such thing as a black, you know, black is just the color of our skin and who you are, everyone's. So there's no box that we could all possibly fit in. So don't like drink the Kool-Aid and believe that you're supposed to be what anybody else imagines you to be.
Great.
Unless you're acting in a film and you're playing a part, but like it's your life, it's you. And especially with social media now, whoever you create, that's gonna be around forever.
Yeah. So be careful what
you do. So you've got to make the right part of your history, be on the right side of your own history.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
Well,
I'm saying it like, wow. It's pretty.
So, yeah. Anyway, so
amazing, Michael Brown.
Anyway, we've sort of, if I was to say, outstayed our welcome when it comes to how long we've been going.
Yes.
And so lots to think about, and I think this whole this conversation and a conversation of for change, and it's really about everyone getting not just heads, but about getting hearts around what does change look like for all of us. What does it look like? What does it feel like? What does, rather than, hey, here's the tick the box, but we're talking about a real sense of change where we're all human beings.
Yeah.
And we live in a world, imagine what that'd be like. So anyway, so thanks for tuning in. Hope this has helped. Remember, this is all about a conversation. And it's not a conversation. It's a conversation over extended period of time. And let's all stay on this journey. And let's really believe, just maybe this is the generation where history might be able to look back and say, well, it started in this age and it finished in the 2020s. Who knows? Maybe we can see a generation of young people coming through that it's just not going to be like it's been for everybody else. So, and let's make it Christ-centered. That's the big challenge.
Yeah.
Thanks for being with us.
Thank you.
You're awesome.
Thanks for having us.